All right, thank you very much for being here. This is joint work with engineers. My paper is about climate change and the opportunity cost of conflict. And I apologize for my voice, which is still not very good. I was down with an unidentified bug for all week, but it's impossible to get tested in this country. So this is the right format of presentation for me.
I really appreciate you giving the presentation under these circumstances.
So contrary to Jesse's paper, ours actually just recently got through the last round of revise and resubmit at a science journal. So at this point, you are very welcome to read and share and distribute the paper. I will put the citation again at the end. So anyways, quickly on the authors. I'm Michele Muller-Itten, and there are four of the engineers that are also on this paper, three from my own institution in Notre Dame, Kevin Rush, Diogo Bolstra, and Mark Muller, and then David Drala from Sac State. So what motivated our project was essentially, just a discussion around what the link between climate change, the climate and conflict is, and what that means for climate change. There are sort of three empirical irregularities that you hear all the time within this literature and that are cited over. That are cited over and over. The first is that if you look across countries, fighting happens in poor places. The second very established fact is that if you look within a country, then it's during the bad years where fighting happens. And I just put one citation each, there are many more. So there's at least one. And then if we think about, so bad times often meaning times with particularly low rainfall or just bad environmental conditions. And the third fact is if you look at the climate change literature, they predict many more of those. And so the question then is, should we expect that climate change leads to more conflict in the future? And if you combine facts two and three here, it sounds, well, if wars occur during anonymously dry years and climate change leads to more dry years, then yes, there should be more wars. And that's oftentimes sort of the argument that we've heard being made, at least informally. But there's a problem with that because a year is currently anonymously dry, and now there are more of those, it changes not just the fact how many dry years there are, but also what is the actual normal. And so if you switch the climate regime, essentially what you're doing is you're defining a new normal. What's your new normal for what a regular growing season looks like? And so if we're thinking about this within a cost-benefit framework, where people evaluate a cost of fighting versus a benefit, then the problem is that the shift in climate regimes affects both the cost and the benefit of conflict. And so this was really the starting point for this. So we wanted to see, what if we actually try to take this a bit more formally, and we want to explore what actually happens if you do this. So we want to take the standard models and just see in a theoretical exploration, what can we say? Does it still go one way, or could it go the other way? And what are the driving forces? So this is a little schematic of what we're doing. Essentially, what we're going to do is we're going to have assume a rainfall distribution. And then we're going to assume that this rainfall distribution determines agricultural income via a crop model, which is something that agronomists use very often. So we'll use the standard model there. And then once we have the agricultural income distribution, we're going to use a classic model of opportunity cost of conflict to decide whether when people go to war and estimate the likelihood of conflict. And so the models that we're going to use for the crop model is just a very simple model that's used, for example, by Butter, in many more is a way of relating how much rainfall is there to how many plants grow. The model that's more on the econ side is the classic Chesang and Padre-Miguel model, which many of you may already be familiar with, but I'll go over it in the next two slides, just to be catch up those who aren't. So that if you look at the horizontal direction, we're using already established models. What we want to ask is the vertical question. That's the new thing here. We want to ask what happens if we change the rainfall distribution in some way that climate change scientists tell us it will change, and we propagate that through those two models. What does it mean for the conflict likelihood? So that's what we're gonna do here. So just to quickly catch you up on Chesang and Padre-Miguel's model, the idea is that there are two groups of farmers here, blue and orange, and they can either farm, and if they farm, the profitability of their labor depends on rainfall, or they could go to war. If they decide to go to war, if they decide to attack their opponent, that has some, that diverts a fraction of productive resources. So in this example, a third of the resources are wasted on preparing for war, going to war. And that represents the opportunity cost of fighting. They have less income because of that. But one of them will win. And if you are the first attacker, you have a higher than one half chance of winning. If you do win, then you annex your opponent's territory and you can have both territories forever. And so in the future, you'll have more income for all future periods. And so those are the future benefits for fighting. And so, by the way, what they show is that if the opportunity cost is low, or the benefits of, or the probability of winning is high, nobody can commit to peace. And so this is essentially a bargaining breakdown that leads to war. Now, the next extension that they do, which is relevant for our model, is that in reality, crop yields depend on rainfall. And so in some, if it rains a lot, you may have a very high return to labor on your farm. But in years where it rains very little, you may have a very low return. And so if you do that, because the opportunity cost, the fraction of your current crop, is determined only by an individual random draw, while the benefit from future crops, the returns that you get if you win, are determined by the mean of the distribution. What you get out of it is that the years in which the benefits outweigh the cost are those where you have a particularly bad drought. So conflicts will occur during drought. So this is Chesang and Padre-Miguel, which can model, that basically explains the fact number two that I mentioned before. So what happens in this model is the farmers endogenously set a cutoff for below what conditions they go to war, and if the climate draw is bad enough, they start fighting. Now what we want to do is we want to figure out what happens if we change the distribution. And because the change in the distribution affects both the cost and the benefit, we want to figure out what is the effect on the equilibrium. So if you want to take into account that they may adjust their threshold below which they fight, and just figure out, does the end probability of fighting go up or down? So we want to do essentially a comparative statics approach. Now, the problem is if you just change a distribution, that's not very conducive to comparative statics because a distribution is an infinitely dimensional object. So what we need to do is we need to essentially parametrize it in a simple way that's tractable, but also a realistic description of how rainfall is distributed and how it affects crop yields. And so for that, and how it's affected by climate change. So for that, what we're using is just doing assumptions that hydrologists like to do. So what we're assuming is that rainfall is, let me get the picture. Sorry, my mouse is. That rainfall is gamma distributed, and then essentially this is the distribution that we assume for rainfall, and then we take this distribution, and this is the crop model I referred to, which essentially is just a concave increasing function that says, if you draw a certain rainfall, what's the agricultural income? So the idea is that the first rainfall changes your income a lot, and then at some point it doesn't change it anymore. Now in the simplest specification, we assume it's just increasing. You could assume that if you have too much rainfall, so you have a flood, it goes down again. We have an extension where we look at a model like that. We actually also have a model, I just want to briefly mention it, where we assume that the driving climate variable is temperature, not rainfall, and we relate that. I'm happy to talk about that during Q&A, but to keep the narrative simple, I just want to stick to this one here, which is the main one that we have in the paper. So you take a draw from here, this relates rainfall to income, and then you can compute what, therefore, the resulting income distribution is that people are facing. So this is what we're doing to relate rainfall to agricultural income. And so now we want to ask that we have those two models in place. Oh, sorry, I did not say what we assume. We're going to assume that what climate change does is just increase the coefficient of variation of rainfall. So the thing that happens if we have with climate change, a common assumption is that it essentially makes rainfall more variable. And so we want to see if we change. So now we have a one parameter that we can change. If we change the CV of rainfall, will probability of conflict go up or down? And now I can click on that. And so here is the graph that just answers that initial question. I plotted here on the x-axis the CV of rainfall, and on the y-axis conflict probability for some parameters. And the purple and the pink and the red line are just for slightly different parameters of offensive advantage. So they're close together, but what you can see is that they diverge in what the predictions are. The red line, you would have the simple narrative where yes, more climate change is always bad for conflict, because if you have a higher coefficient of variation, you always have more conflict. But for the pink line, it could actually go down under some circumstances. Now, we're not trying to fit this to any particular geographic location. It's very abstract and the models are too simplistic to do that. We just want to see whether the reasoning is consistent, whether we need to take into account this adaptation effect. And so what we're showing is essentially, no, it's not always as straightforward. It could go up, but it could also go down. In essence, what could happen is a discouragement effect from low future crops outweighs. So if we both realize climate has changed, but we also realize that in the future, it's gonna be so bleak, we might not wanna go to war. Even today, it doesn't cost much. It's because I don't earn anything from having your territory in the future. It also means that we need to be careful when we extrapolate from past observations to make predictions about the future. So when we look at under what conditions do we have war in the past, and then we see how often those conditions appear, that doesn't mean that there will be conflict in those conditions in the future, because people adapt and they adapt the threshold under which they fight. Now that is somewhat science again, because we don't. There are many parameters here that it's hard to know what the right assumption is on what their value should be. We want to understand a little bit more. Can we dissect this? What is the things that are driving this? And so we look a little bit more into the econ model. And what we find is that there are actually three statistics of the income distribution that are relevant for how people set their fighting threshold. And those is what we call here the multiple dimensions of climate change that people adapt to. The first important factor is the income shock frequency. So theta tilde here represents the threshold below which we'll fight. And so f of theta tilde, how often is the rainfall below that threshold, is how often we'll actually fight. So if that goes up, then mechanically, even if we did not adjust our threshold, well, we would fight more because the conditions under which we fight occur more often, but we would also actually react to that by adjusting our threshold so that we would have even more conflict. And that's pretty straightforward, and that's the simple story that we've been thinking about so far, that comes out of fact two and three. But the second impact is that if you keep the other statistics the same and you just lower the mean income, so you just make it less profitable to farm on average, then if you think about it, that has no effect on your current draw. You're only changing the future benefits, the expected future benefits. And so if that's the case, you're just making war less attractive because you would stand to earn less from it. So if you just lower the mean income, you would decrease the frequency of war. The last one has to do with how destructive conflicts are. So how much resources are wasted on average by going to war rather than farming. And if that goes down, if conflicts become less destructive on average, for example, because droughts are more severe, then the probability of war also goes down. And this is the reason here is mainly because of the preemptive motive for war. So one reason why you wait go to war today is because then you know you don't have to go to war tomorrow because you might have already eliminated your opponent tomorrow. But if conflicts are less destructive on average, thank you. If conflicts are less destructive on average, then it makes peace more sustainable because that potential future cost of having to fight in the future gets smaller. So having less destructive conflict will actually lower the frequency of conflict. So that is sort of what the theory gives us as to what the theory points to as what the relevant aspects of the income distribution are. But the important thing is that while each of those, if you change just one of those, you get an unambiguous prediction of how your probability of war will respond. The reality is if you change any climate parameter, it will typically affect all three. And so the question is really which one outweighs. So if I take an example here for a distribution, again, on the x-axis, I just plot the CV of water. And then on the top panel, you see the effect on income. I plotted the three different statistics. And you see, that, for example, the income shock frequency, at first it goes down, and then it goes up. And in the bottom panel, you see the implied change in the fighting probability. Each line on top and on the bottom, the sign agrees with the table, but they're just different effects. And if you sum them all together, one or the other may outweigh. So in this example, you'd have, for small CVs, you'd first have a decrease. If you look at a red line, you first have a decrease in the probability of conflict, but then eventually you have an increase. And so it could go either way comes from. Now, that's nice from a theory perspective. It helps us understand a little more. But it's not necessarily quite practical yet. And moreover, there may be some things that sort of hurt the eye when you look at it. One thing is that in this table, I said if mean income goes down, then you have less conflict. And that seems just very much at odds with the fact number one I posted at the beginning, where I said fighting happens in poor places, which have a lower mean income. So I just want to be clear that out before we go further. Those two are not contradicting each other. So one thing we already know from Chesang and Pedro Miguel's paper is that if the poor countries just have a scaled down income distribution from the rich countries, then the model would imply no effect on probability of war. That's what they show, because essentially everything is just scales down and you would have the same probability of war in rich and poor places. But what you can also show is that if that's not actually what happens. It's not just that poor countries have also less variance. This is just scaled down version of a rich country, but it's more of a shift. They're just poorer always, sort of maybe another extreme. then under realistic assumptions, actually P4 can increase. And the idea again is it will not, then poor countries do not just differ in one of those three statistics, but in all three. And that's really important. It's always all three that are affected. In particular, the dominant here being the income shock frequency. If you have some fixed cutoff and then you shift the distribution down, well, that F, the probability of being below that cutoff just got really much higher. And so that can easily outweigh the actually calming effect of having less to gain from attacking your opponent. All right, so having at least gotten that out of the way, I wanna use the rest of the time to draw more actionable links to empirical research, because there is no complicated empirical specification here. But I do hope that our paper can motivate some future empirical research, because I can't do it myself. So one of the things I think that is relevant here is that we know that climate can affect conflict through multiple mechanisms. So it could be this opportunity cost that I just spent a while talking about, but it could also be physiology or a technical advantage. It could be that people are just more angry, or it's easier or harder to attack your opponent. It could be that if you have bad crops and there is less tax income, and so states have less capacity to maintain peace. And so that begs the question, well, how important are opportunity costs really? And I think in that regard, thinking about this table can help us understand better, disentangle between opportunity costs and these other possible mechanisms. For example, if we think about the mean income pathway, just highlight that one. If mean income goes down, opportunity costs would say probability of war goes down. But if we think about decreased state capacity, that would go the other way, because if income goes down, then the state would have less capacity because less tax revenue. So that would point to probability of war going up. So looking a little bit more into the theory could help us possibly disentangle between these different mechanisms. Moreover, if we think that people are actually updating their belief about what the climate is in a way of Bayesian updating, then they would, each time that they get a new information about the climate, they would update what they think the distribution is, and translating the table into those updates would imply that if you have a conflict in recent past, you would have more conflict. If you had a bad crop in the recent past, you'd have less conflict. And if you had a very costly conflict in the recent past, you'd also have less conflict. Now, I don't think all of these are useful per se, because the first one, for example, could also be explained by just the time persistence of conflict. But the second one I think is interesting, because we already regress, and it's both interesting and actionable. We already regress conflict on rainfall. And we see that there's a strong correlation between current rainfall and conflict. We see that if we have a low current rainfall, then we have more conflict. That's the Chesling and Padre-Miguel model. But this is saying if we would actually regress this against historic rainfall, you would expect to see the opposite pattern. Because if you have a bad crop in the recent past, that should have a calming effect, which is opposite to the currently bad crop, which would have make us more aggressive. So hopefully this could sort of pave the way, using actual data that we already have, to distinguish a little bit more between these mechanisms, because also this would go a different way for these other mechanisms. So in conclusion, I think the main things that we can learn from this research is that we need to be careful when we're extrapolating from past findings, because we don't want to forget about adaptation, which seems like something that we as economists are always preaching. But in this literature, it's sometimes not being that carefully done when we're thinking about the impact of climate change. So the impact of an anomaly is not the same as the impact of a sustained change in the distribution. And the other thing is that agents strategically adapt to multiple facets of climate change. In particular, if we think about whether we have more intense or more frequent droughts. Those in our model give us opposite predictions. More intense droughts is then less resources are wasted on conflict, that would decrease conflict. But if the droughts are just more frequent, that would increase conflict. And so sometimes what we're doing is we're treating these just as bad years and good years, and we're not looking at what makes them bad or good. And we sort of miss the link between the theory models and the applied papers. And if we can strengthen that a bit, I think we could do better research. So if we think a little bit harder about what are the parts in the data that most nicely correspond to the parameters in our theory models, hopefully that could give us some more leeway in identifying the relative strength of opportunity cost. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Michele, especially given circumstances. That was a really fantastic presentation. It really well, fantastically delivered. So really appreciate it. From any of the attendees, please either raise your hand or type something in the Q&A if you have a question. Give everyone a moment in case need a little bit of time. Okay, and Jesse or Ryan, I think Ryan might be around the corner, but if either of you have a question for Michele, go ahead.
It's not so much a question, more, well, I guess it's a question. I'm not quite sure to think about trying to separately identify the threshold effects versus the mean shifts. In particular, just because that seems like one of these higher order type moments that's going to be weirdly endogenous looking at stuff from the past anyway. And so I just kind of, I think it's when we think about sort of bringing this into a forward looking thing with this specific model, right? I'm still not sure like what the, maybe there's some kind of like spatial intuition we could think about here with intensity of droughts influence or decreasing likelihood of conflict going forward, or, you know, because I think it is simultaneously we have this sort of shift in the distribution of temperatures. We also have this shift in not only technologies, but also just like styles of war. And so I guess maybe to kind of bring into an actual question, like where would we expect this to potentially go if we think about the fact that a whole bunch of the conflicts that we had in the latter half of the 20th century, where we're parameterizing these models, were like local quasi-civil conflicts related to like Cold War great power stuff. Whereas we might very well expect, you know, if you go over and look at like DOD planning for the next couple of decades, that it's gonna be a very different style of conflict with a lot more remote action. Right, and so I just wonder whether or not we think about this type of parameterization, whether or not there might be some kind of like both a, you know, spatial, whatever it is, just general like big shifts in the distribution of these things we're talking about anyway, that might make it hard to take this theory model and push it forward this way.
Yeah, so a very valid question. I'm not sure I can address it fully, but at least validate it as an important question. And I did not mean here with this bullet point here saying that we should specifically try in the data to distinguish between intense and frequent droughts. I just put that there because we say climate change leads to more intense and frequent droughts. And then we use that as one type of information where actually it's true that might have opposing effects. But with respect to your question, I think it's definitely relevant that this model is very much based on, for example, is based on agricultural productivity driving the decision to go to war or not. So I think that limits the type of conflicts that it is a good model for. But I think what it within that type of conflict, I think one thing that is also just pointing to is there is benefit in studies that just try to characterize the income distribution more and to clarify the link between climate and agricultural income. or non-agricultural income? How is non-agricultural income related to climate variables? So I don't think I have the answers for that, but I hope that this research can sort of say, if you want to have prediction for how climate change affects conflict, there is so much more we need to know, and all those other studies can really help us answer that question, because right now there is really just a lack of data.